We've got two chairs at the front. No takers. Right. Well, look, good morning, everyone, and welcome all of you to this celebration of the life of Diane Cooper. My name is Maxine Lowry. I'm a marriage celebrant, a civil celebrant, and thank you for being here to pay your respects to Diane, who passed away last week. She was 63. Firstly, I would like to extend my sympathy to the family and thank them for the honour of being the person who stands here today to conduct the celebration of Diane's wonderful life. Diane was a much loved wife to Phillip, devoted and loving mother to Matthew and Nichola, grandmother to Sarah and Julia, mother-in-law to Paul and Gemma. She was the daughter of Alan and Nancy George, near Henshaw, both deceased, and she had lots of brothers and sisters. We had Shirley, Gay, Lindsay, who's deceased, Robert, Michael, Bruce, Margaret, Ricky, who's deceased. She was a daughter-in-law to Ruth and Mervyn, who's not with us. So thanks everyone for being here to honour Diane and to share in that common bond of love and respect for this lovely lady. We do have lots of people here from interstate. I've been given some names: Bruce and Julie George, Dallas and Matthew Byron, Leith and Cameron Tweed, Leith and Thomas Mundy, Josh and Kath Mundy, David and Janine Richardson, Laura Richardson. So there are some of the people who've travelled a long way. There are also family and friends watching on live webcast from interstate and overseas. And I'd like to pay special recognition to Nicola's Florida-based family, her husband Paul, and her daughters Sarah and Julia. I think I'm looking at the camera right now, guys, but I couldn't be 100% certain. So I do hope that people who are streaming in do get the benefit of how beautifully Diane's life's going to be celebrated. Now, the heartbreaking news came last July. Diane and Phil had just returned from 7 weeks in the US. A CNS lymphoma is a cruel diagnosis. It's got a very poor outcome. So why would anyone be surprised to learn that Diane took it in her stride? She never complained. She never felt sorry for herself, but the words that the family used to describe how she approached this was that she showed extraordinary strength and composure. So today, it's an opportunity to remember Diane, give thanks for all the special and precious memories that she's left you with. Things that happen here today will trigger your memories of experiences you have with Diane. It'll help you to reflect on your relationship with her and be satisfied that she has been and she'll continue to be part of your life and your story. There wasn't a lot of time to say goodbye. She was robbed of many more happy years with her childhood sweetheart and partner in crime. And the pain being felt here today, you can't really plan for that. The pain is a reflection of your love for Diane, so hopefully today you can remember her with love and gratitude. Remember the old Diane. Don't just remember the last few weeks or months. Remember there's a lot to be thankful for, and we're going to try and cover a pretty rich old life. She did a lot. I do know that she would be really wanting you to smile today, to remember the fun you had, and to recall the essence of her fun-loving, vibrant and cheeky personality. Now, I'm going to just try and encapsulate the main story of Diane's life. It won't be easy, and it's going to take me a little while. So Diane was born to Alan and Nancy George. She was the second youngest of a large family, I mentioned that, 9 children. And the family home was 36 Elwick Road, Glenorchy. That was until she married at the tender age of 18 in 1973. She went to Glenorchy Primary School and Cosgrove High. then started work with her sister Margaret at, some of you will remember this name, Donald Gorringe Automotive. After she had the children, she continued to work for the Builder Labourers Federation, the BLF, for 10 years, which was under the reins of the late Jim Bacon. How she put up with those rascals, Phil said he'll never know. Di then worked for Ob Gyne at Hill Street, West Hobart, later moving to Calvary, where she continued to work for some 18 years until her illness last year. Such a stark contrast to the BLF. Di treated her Ob Gyne colleagues like family. She took every possible opportunity to feed them. Phillip met Diane briefly in 1970 through mutual friends, but it took another year for them to hook up and start dating. Phil found out that after their first meeting, Di would try to manage the traffic light at the corner of Elwick and Main Road. The idea was to try and catch a glimpse of Phil when he was travelling home from work in his infamous VW. If Phil had any sense, he would have faked a breakdown to strike up a conversation with Diane. But it was a year later that they met again by chance on the Macquarie Street Pier. That was next to visiting Australian naval ships. It was during the regatta season. Phil recalls rescuing three pretty girls from the sailors. And he remembers a fairly broad smile from a young lady sitting in the middle rear seat of his infamous VW. The two sisters, known then as Twiggy 1 and Twiggy 2, plus a friend, were delivered home safely. Phil and I managed to stay a couple. They continued dating. They were engaged in 1972 and married at Mooners St Mary's Church on the 17th of Feb 1973 by Reverend Potter. That year, Nichola came along. Matthew was the second addition to the family 25 months later, and home was at 8 Marsh Street, Newtown, until they moved into their newly built family home at Glenlusk Road, Berrydale, which is really well known now as Glenlusk Gardens. Di, she was an active netballer. She played for the AYC Mooner team, and many of her teammates have kept touch right through to the present day. Hip pain slowed her down briefly, but she dealt with that through a successful hip replacement in 2013 and completed the Point to Pinnacle run 2 years later. After she was diagnosed with her illness, Matthew and Gemma honoured her by running the 2017 Point to Pinnacle, raising money for the Leukaemia Foundation. Now, the travel. It'd be an understatement to say Di and Phil have travelled extensively. It started in 1995 with a six-week self-guided tour of the west coast of America. It coincided with the American Rhododendron Society conference. And the trip exposed them to the generosity of the American people through homestays. And in fact, it was through their experience of homestays that they decided to open their own home to short-stay accommodation. And Di and Phil have notched up 9 different visits to the States to visit Nichola, Paul, Sarah and Julia. But of course they've evaluated by visiting many other states while they've been over with the family, and they've managed 3 around the world tickets that managed to get them home via Europe. So they've really, really seen the sights. Last year, in May and June, saw them travelling with their companions, the Dorans and the Monaghans. They started in Miami, travelled the east coast of Florida to Nicola's home in Jacksonville, and while they stayed with Nichola and the family, their companions ventured on their own US and Canadian tours before there was a big reunion for 10 days in New York. That was around the 4th of July celebrations. So Phil reckons they walked across Manhattan and Brooklyn, knocking up about 15 kilometres a day. And it was only 6 days after they returned that Di got her diagnosis. And that certainly started many hospital visits and treatments. That's really what's brought us here today. So during this epic fight, very brave fight, Di and Phil were overwhelmed by the love and compassion shown by that large family of large circle of family and friends. Her brief stay in palliative care saw visits from more than 250 repeat visits, so not 250 different people, but 250 visits, even included Sammy the cat. And before she left home for the last time, the family was so pleased that Di had a really, really joyous Easter Sunday afternoon with her family and her closest friends in her own home. It was a beautifully radiant sunshine kind of a day. Diane's work colleagues, who was a remarkable tribute to Di, have closed the Obgani office today to attend. They do recall one endearing travel tale. Phil sent a video to Di's work address. He didn't include a subject line. So they're watching this video, watching the screen. There was a dot. The dot started to grow bigger and bigger and bigger until they realised it was Di coming out of the sky, all suited up. She'd just completed a control line jump from the Auckland Tower, so they had to work it out. And always after a bargain, Di boasted that she actually got a second jump for free. And speaking of things that bounce, I've been told to say this, Nichola recalls the first time she brought Paul home and Di had just very vivaciously announced that she was just home from a wet t-shirt competition. But before you judge, it was to raise money for TasBash, and I think it was called Chests for Charity. Earlier that day, Paul had met Phil for the first time following two nights when Nichola slunk home to Glenlusk in the very early hours of the morning. So fatherly Phil gave Paul a stern head-to-toe look up and down and decided, is this young Launceston reporter going to be a corrupting force? But after hearing the wet t-shirt story, Nichola concluded her dad had bigger problems to worry about. I think Paul got off the hook. Matthew remembers Diane's hospitality and catering skills. She began early, transitioning from hockey, netball and softball presentations to hosting mass slumber parties for the kids. Both children commented on Di's over-catering. Never were you going to run out of food at Di's place. She must have been a fairly amazing cook because she gets a mention here. She learnt from anyone who would teach her, anyone who'd open up their kitchen, beginning with the Breeders, an Italian family down the road. Apparently she made the perfect lasagna and her bolognese wasn't bad either. She extended her talents to Chinese and Japanese feasts, in large because she wanted the student billets that she hosted to not feel homesick, which is such a lovely, thoughtful thing. It was a love of food and cooking that we could say was the catalyst to all this gallivanting around the world chasing the best seafood chowder. Apparently, Phil and Di's critique of the soup dish was always fun to listen to, even when it was a tale of returning to the same eatery to get another take on the same soup. Di loved her chowder and she loved scallops. Glenlusk Gardens, arguably the entertainment capital of Greater Berrydale, saw plenty of dinner parties. Di's cooking and hospitality skills were perfectly complemented by Phil's surgeon-like precision, cooking all manner of meat on the barbecue. Di was known for her famous Devonshire teas with homemade raspberry jam and whipped cream. That was a real crowd pleaser, especially with the Rhododendron Society. And even when she wasn't well, Di insisted she make the currant cake for their Christmas raffle. It wasn't all just high tea and kids' parties, though. The fancy dress parties at Glenlusk were marked in everyone's calendar, along with an annotation, no children allowed. What happens at Glenlusk stays at Glenlusk on those nights. There was a camping group the enthusiastic bunch of families who usurped every campsite they went to. I know the camping group are here. Camping trips consumed every available annual and public holiday. Upon arrival, the kids would leap from the vehicles to check out the sites, and they would only come back when they were hungry. Di wonders if that was the origin of Matthew's nomadic lifestyle. Or perhaps it was when she put him on a plane as a 14-year-old to work at his uncle's Coles supermarket in Geelong. Di's son-in-law Paul says he will forever remember the overwhelming love Diane gave and received from her granddaughters Sarah and Julia. It's not possible for a person to love their grandchildren more. He says he fondly remembers the times Nana and the girls spent at the beach, swimming at the pool, baking cakes and cookies, going on road trips in the States, hiking in Tasmania, cards, jigsaw puzzles, cuddling on the couch. He remembers Diane as a very energetic, adventurous, fun-loving and joyful person, someone who always put others before herself, who never complained about her worries or ailments, and she loved her family with heart and soul. Family was important. I guess when you're from a family of nine, family is very close. Holidays were always dedicated to being with Nichola and Paul and those two precious granddaughters, Sarah and Julia. Phil, Matt and Nichola recounted that Di's determination and resolve in her final hours saw her fighting. She just wanted to stay with them. And it was only after they decided to leave her in peace for a short time, they decided to walk up the Hobart Rivulet to the Cascade Brewery, stop for a drink in the brewery. It was only then that Di finally let go and took her last few breaths. Fittingly, one of her last acts was to leave her beloved family members with treasured keepsakes, not only so they'd have something tangible to remind them of her, but so they would be reminded of the good she saw in them. And there's words engraved only in tiny font in personalised pieces of jewellery. Small words, but giant in meaning, and they reflect the biggest and most noble of human virtues. So the people who were lucky enough to have one of these bestowed on them by Diane feel she really is the worthy one. So these gifts have been planted among family members and her many friends who've had the honour of knowing her. Given to children, grandchildren, sisters and brothers, the mementos will be a reminder to live up to the values and principles that Diane embodied. I do believe one of them is on the back of your order of service today. Phil was left speechless when she presented him with a ring containing gold and diamonds from her eternity ring, symbolising their lifelong love affair. And staying faithful to her core values till the very end, Diane was still thinking of others before herself. Now I'd like to invite you to enjoy the first of two montages. The theme of this montage is Diane's early life. It will be followed by one of her close friends, Elaine Doran, who has something she will share. So we'll hand over to the to my friend there for the first montage.
Spaces between us, you This is a tribute to Diane, our gracious, joy-filled friend. As Maxine has so eloquently spoken of in the preceding eulogy, we are farewelling Diane, our warm, generous, inspiring, caring, spectacular, and precious friend. As we reflect on the immense kind-heartedness Diane showed to all with whom she came in contact, we know what Diane meant to us in life. And we know that she will continue to care for those she loved and for whom she lived her life. These beautiful words that I'm about to read truly reflect the incredible caring influence Diane has been to many, many people. If we listen with our hearts, we will know they are thoughts that Diane would wish for us. When you feel a hand on your shoulder or a kiss right out of thin air, you hear your name and then turn around, but there's nobody there. That'll be me. If you see a star shining brightly for you and you're making wishes and they're coming true, know that I have put in a good word for you. That'll be me. That'll be me. Time is sure to help your heart to heal. You know, this really doesn't mean the end. They say friends are forever. And I'm sure we will meet again. But until then, I'm never far away. Diane, my prayer for you is in this spiritual Irish blessing. And Gemma may know these words. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be ever at your back. May the sun shine warm on your face. The rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand.
Thank you, Elaine. You've got your order of service. I will just explain that. We do have a montage now of the later years. That will be followed by a video in which Di's younger granddaughter, Julia, 13-year-old Julia, is going to send a message. And following that, Jeanette is going to share something that she's written as well. So please enjoy the later years.
So this is who I am, and this is all I know, and I must choose to live for all that I can give, the spark that makes the power grow, and I will stand for my dream if I can, symbol of my faith in who I am, but you are my only. And I must follow on the road that lies ahead. Now won't let my heart control my head, but you are my only. We don't say goodbye. We don't say I know what I've got to be. Immortality. I make my journey through. we don't say goodbye.
I'm Julia, if you don't know me. I'm usually the one that jokes around and does all the pranks, but I'm going to try and be serious for like 2 minutes. It's going to be pretty hard, but we'll see how it goes. I'm sorry about the background. It's my unmade messy bread. Sorry, Mom. Yeah, you're probably like really embarrassed right now, but it's okay. So, Nana was an amazing person. I loved her so much. She did all the stuff in the world for me. She baked lemon squares, she baked caramel slices, she baked all this stuff. And we all know that she was an amazing cook. And she always cleaned my room when she was over here. And if she was over here right now, she'd be yelling at me because my bed wasn't made. Because Nana loves being clean. And we all love Nana, and she's just an amazing person, and she has a great laugh, and I miss her so much, and we all miss her. But we know that she's in a better place now, and that she's up in heaven celebrating her mom's birthday with her and saying hello to all her brothers and sisters. And Nana always gave me gifts, and she was so generous, and she gave me my basketball boots for my birthday, and Granddad, thank you. And they, whenever I put them on, they make me think of Nana, and I'm very thankful I have Nana in my life. And Granddad, of course, Granddad, I'm sorry if I'm leaving you out, but you know this is all about Nana right now. So, well, I don't know what else to put because this is supposed to be a short video, but thank you for coming. I'm not there, so I don't really know, but thank you.
Wow, that was a good effort for a 13-year-old. So, yes, Janet will be coming forward, and I didn't mention Gemma. Yes, so after Jeanette, then Gemma also will be coming forward. That's Diane's daughter-in-law.
Perhaps I'd like to thank Julia for lightening our mood. I'm very nervous here. In further reference to Di's gifts of jewellery and their inscriptions, I'll begin with a string of seemingly random but emotive words. Each item and each inscription personally chosen by Di herself. Individually, they are intimately connected to immediate family members. Joy, devotion, shine, thoughtful, giving, nurturing, eternity, promise. Journeys. Journeys begin and journeys end. Journeys take us to places we've never been. Sometimes we have choice. Sometimes they take us to places that we may not want to go. Journeys meander, connecting us with others. Yet they're very personal. The journeys of others makes question our own. What is important that each journey is a cause for celebration, acknowledgement and respect. The journey we have come here to celebrate today was so unique and incredibly intertwined with us all. We are so much better for this. Journeys begin and journeys end, not always to script, but each a celebration in their own right. Joy, devotion, shine, thoughtful, giving, nurturing, eternity, and above all, promise. Thank you.
Of all the people here today, I've known you the shortest time, but I know you've touched each and every life in the beautiful way you touched mine. A thoughtful and quiet woman, you were kind and soft and true, except when you let out that wicked laugh and your fun and playful side shone through. Your husband described you as an angel. Your two children couldn't love you anymore. You lived for your two granddaughters, whom we know you worship and adore. You will never not be with us, and this I want you to know. Your memory will always be kept alive as we watch your grandson grow. I will remember you soaking up the sunshine with a gin and tonic on the go. I'll remember you banging around in the kitchen with at least three different recipes in full flow. I know I speak on behalf of everyone to say we're honoured to have been part of your life. You are a real lady of strength and beauty, a loving friend, sister, mother, nana and wife. It was too soon to have to say goodbye, but you fought this brave battle with grace. Let's celebrate the time we had with you, wishing you perfect peace in your final resting place.
Thanks, Jeanette, and thanks, Gemma. The final message today is on behalf of Di's 16-year-old granddaughter, Sarah McPherson. Sarah's watching online from Florida. We've heard from Julia. This is Sarah's letter to her grandma, or her nana. Dear Nana, at the beginning of every school year, kids already begin counting down the days till summer vacation. Most of them just look forward to going to the beach, hanging out with friends, or just not having to be in school. Well, for me, it was different. At the beginning of every school year, I would count down the days until I got to see my grandparents, counting down the days until I either had to try and sit still on a plane for 30 to 40 hours, or until I would sit patiently at Jacksonville Airport waiting for you to walk to baggage claim, where we stood holding giant neon posters that we made 3 weeks in advance because we were so excited to see you. Or those times Mum and Dad told you we didn't come to the airport to pick you up and then we would sneak up behind you and surprise you. Or at least Julia and I thought we did. Every day that summer grew closer, I would get more and more excited to see you, to make more memories at the pool with the same one bathing suit you would wear, the pink one with the black polka dots. More trips to Starbucks, way too many of them, and all the things you would spoil us with, for which I never got to express how thankful I was. And even when you would drag us to boring sightseeing places that Julia and I didn't really want to go to, those memories are still ingrained in my mind and always will be. The more I write about all my memories with you, I start to realise how much of an impact you've had in shaping who I am today, how non-teenagerish you've made me become, which I love. For one, I'm excited to see my grandparents. You don't hear that very often. Second, when we come over to Australia, I enjoy sitting down with all your friends and listening to all the old lady gossip while I paint all their nails and serve you biscuits and tea. I think that's you guys. It's funny to say out loud that I would much rather spend all my school holidays with my grandparents than with my friends. But I am, so that is my life, and I wouldn't want to change it for the world. At home in Florida, the one thing that always sets me apart from everyone else is Australia. I've never been prouder to be anything in my entire life. I have too much love for this country you've exposed me to and made me fall in love with it. Each walk we've been on, each mountain we've climbed, and the bike rides I thought I didn't want to go on, but they turned out enjoyable, just make me love this country more and more. It never ceases to amaze me how beautiful the country is and how much there is to see and do. It's hard to believe that a huge chunk of my life is actually spent in Australia. My most amazing memories are there, coming to see you at your house and going to see all my friends I only get to see once every 2 years is so special to me, you'll never know. The amount of happiness and joy you've brought into my life is astonishing, and I will never create better memories than the ones I've made in your garden and in the kitchen, and yes, even at Northgate. You've made me appreciate how lucky I am and how special this family is. There's not one like it. I love you so much. So you must be very proud, Nichola, the two girls. Very hard to be so separated from them, but they've done a beautiful tribute to their grandmother. I've been asked on behalf of the family to thank Dr. Rosie Harrop, as well as the doctors, nurses and support staff of both the Royal Hobart Hospital and Calvary Hospital for their wonderful care of Di. You all know Diane was a great lover of her garden, and alongside Phil she created that wonderful oasis at their Glenlusk home that was the setting for, they believe, over 50 marriage ceremonies. I was lucky enough to perform several weddings there. Di was a keen gardener, but the Cooper family has asked that in lieu of sending flowers today, that donations be made to the Leukemia Foundation. There will be a box next door after the service. Thank you for your attendance here. Phil, Nichola and Matt will be delighted if you can join them next door for refreshments immediately following the service. Di, very organised, very thoughtful, has made a special request for scones and jam to be served today, and not just any scones and jam, but made specifically to her family recipe. Why are we not surprised? So hold on to Di in your hearts. Don't part from her hastily. When you leave this room, remember to talk about her often. Think of her with a smile on your face. Remember those themed parties. Remember her over-catering, her currant cakes. There's something about Blackberry Queen as well. I didn't get to the bottom of that one. Her can-do attitude, her generosity and her devotion, which has really shone through here to her family and her friends. There are people here today who, Phil told me, have said she has been the major influence in their life. The major influence. You'll all have your own memories of Di, so treasure them, revisit them. Be thankful that you were her family member, her workmate, her neighbour, her friend. I do have a psalm to read, the Peace Prayer of St. Francis. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love, for it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Can I ask everybody to stand? Love doesn't end with dying or leave in the last breath. For someone you've loved deeply, love goes on forever. So Di, your work on earth is done. You are much loved. Go now with the love and blessing of your beloved family and friends, and may you rest in peace. We farewell Di with one of her favourite songs, relating back to her mother's words in 1973 that she was too young to be married.
She wakes up early every morning. She gets up long before the sunshine. Greets the milkman who's still yawning. And reads the paper for a short time. Calls the kids, get out of bed. They never hear a word she says. Husband stands to leave the table. She says, I hope you have a good day. He thinks one day soon as I'm able, I'll get a job where I get good pay. They find it hard to make ends meet, but they don't mention it, because they have each other and love is free while they're supposed to be too young to be married, too young to be free, too young to be married. But what can they do? They were gonna have a baby. To be married, but what could they do?